Okay.
Teaching of resurrection is monumental in the Christian faith. 15, 12 through 20. But it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead. How can we say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God. For we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead, but he did not raise him back. The dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sin, then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. Only this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be saved. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruit of those who have fallen asleep. This is a central theme in our faith because what separates our faith from religion is the revelation of a living God, that he rose from the dead, and that after he rose, now he literally by his spirit can dwell inside of us. That separates Christianity from religion, right? All these people, whether it's Buddha or Allah or, you know, all these people that people are worshiped, they were just merely humans who will die or are dead. But in fact, Jesus Christ was raised from the dead, the literal grave, as if we could imagine it today, being at a grave site and seeing someone come up out of the ground, or then was the tomb. They were burying in a tomb. The stone was rolled over, and he was not there. So this is why what separates us in our faith and our belief system that we do not waver on, and why Jesus is our foundation, is because he is alive. He is alive in you. He is alive in me, and we represent that on a daily basis. So that's why it's imperative that our belief system does not waver from the fact that we have a living God who is Jesus. That he did die, he was buried, and he did raise him. So, now the last two teachings differ from the first four. The first four deal with the present world and the realm of time. Right? We talked about repentance, we talked about baptism, we talked about both the laying on of hands and our repentance, faith towards God, baptism, and the laying on of hands. Okay, so those first four deal with the present time now. But the last two, which is resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment, deal with the realm of eternity, which is God's being. It is God's existence. Eternity is not endless time, although we think of it like that. It is not the absence of time. It actually differs from time. Okay? It is the uncreated realm where God exists. That is eternity. God actually means self-existing one. So he just always has, he always is, and he always will be. It's just his being, and that is his realm. It is God who created time for us, so that we can have concept of time for his purposes, but in fact, he doesn't rely on time. He doesn't operate on time. He operates from a realm of eternity, which is the uncreated realm, the realm that he lives and dwells in. So it's a little bit different. Isaiah 57:15 says, "For this is what the high and exalted one said, he who lives forever, whose name is holy, I live in a high and holy place, but also with the one who is contrite and lowly in spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite." So what awaits the soul crossing over from this present world to eternity? 1 Corinthians 15:22, "For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive." Now Adam and Eve, we know that representing the beginning of creation, they fell from that direct relationship with God, right? So they fell, sin came in, they realized they were naked, and they were ashamed. So now the rest of humanity, as we are born, we are all separated from our Heavenly Father. A until we come to a present age where we can willingly say, I choose to change my life and live for him. Right? It's like saying my son Isaac, when he decided by himself to say, I love you, Dad, it was because he genuinely loved me and genuinely wanted that natural two-way relationship. And so when we are born in this world, we are actually born separated from God. We are born into sin because all fell through Adam. But here's the hope that we have, that those who come through Christ all shall live again. That is the hope that we have, and that is the hope that we share. So the resurrection of the dead is, death is the universal fate for all through Adam, and resurrection from the dead is the universal appointment of all through Christ. The exceptions are those who don't face physical death. In the scripture, we have Enoch and Elijah. Those two were actually caught up because of their faith, and they pleased the Lord. For some reason, I can't tell you why, God just chose to take them from the earth. Okay? Also, the believers who are alive at the time of Jesus Christ's return will also, the scripture says, be caught up with him, not tasting death. I don't know what that looks like, and we'll kind of go into that in a little bit with the scripture say, but I don't have all the details. I have an imagination, but it can be completely wrong, and we don't know until it actually happens. 1 Corinthians 15, 51-52 says, listen, I tell you, otherwise it's 51. I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep. Sleep, he's talking about death. Okay? All, whatever describes death, he's talking about those who are. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will all be changed. So, non-believers, those who don't know Jesus, will also be resurrected. John 5:28-29, do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done what is good will rise to live, and those who have done what is evil will rise to be condemned. Eternal judgment awaits the entire human race. That is one thing that is inevitable we cannot avoid when we come and face him is judgment. Acts 17:30-31. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. Hebrews 9:27. Just as people are destined to die once, after that, to face judgment. Some will face a second death. Some will only die once. So the three main phases of the resurrection of the dead. Christ and the first fruits, Jesus, the first one to resurrect the dead, and the saints who rose with him. There were actually saints, Old Testament saints, we believe, and the scripture says that there were those others who were raised from the dead when Jesus rose, and they were seen in front of people. Second, are those who are Christ at his second return. All the believers who have died during the preceding ages, and who will be resurrected at Christ's second coming prior to the establishment of his millennial kingdom. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And then there's the end, the final resurrection of all the remaining dead at the close of the millennium. The millennium is just another word for a thousand-year reign. In Revelation, we talk about a thousand-year reign. Let's talk about Jesus Christ as the first fruit. 1 Corinthians 15:20, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. Good morning. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruit of those who have fallen asleep. So what does the first fruit mean? Leviticus 23:10-11. Speak to the Israelites and say to them, when you enter the land I am going to give you, and you reap its harvest, bring to the priest a sheaf of the first grain of your harvest. He is to wave the sheaf before the Lord, so it will be accepted on your behalf. The priest is to wave it on the day after the Sabbath. Now the sheaf is basically a bundle or a package of whatever is being offered. And whether it's grain or, you know, the product they had back in the day in that time. They would package it up and bundle it, and they would bring it, and they would wave it as an offering before the Lord. And they would give their first fruits up of their field, of their crops. So the first production of grain rising from the seed that was buried was brought to the priest. The sheep was waved before the Lord on the Sabbath, just like Jesus was buried on the Sabbath. The Sabbath was the seventh day of the week, or last day, followed by the first day, which speaks of new beginning. Waving the sheep was an act of worship and triumph. Signifies that the rest of the harvest was followed. John 12:24, very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. So let's look at this. We continue on the first fruits. So when Jesus rose from the dead, he did not rise alone. John 5:25, very truly I tell you, a time is coming, and now it's come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God and those who hear the dead. When a single seed is buried, it always brings forth more fruit. Matthew 27:50 and 53. And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from the top to bottom. The earth shook, the rock split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who have died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went in the holy city and appeared to them. So Christ, the single seed, buried alone, right? He was the one that was buried. When he rose, there also was a harvest who rose from the dead with him. Does that make sense of the seed being buried and dying, which produces more seed and more fruit? So we are not sure what happened to these things when they were resurrected. Possibly they ascended with Jesus. We don't really know. The Bible isn't really clear what happened to them. All the Bible says is that they rose also and appeared to many in the Holy Spirit. So many can conjure up ideas, that being one of them, that Jesus ascended. Maybe they went with them. But I'm not really sure. So I cannot make a doctrine out of them.
Or maybe they hung out to plague the religious leaders for 20 years or so.
You never know, right? You never know. So let's look at the first resurrection at the return of Christ and the final resurrection in the end. The first resurrection, those who belong to Christ at his coming, those who died in the previous ages, and those who are alive at his return prior to the establishment of his 1,000-year reign on the earth. The second or final resurrection, called the end, is the final resurrection of all the remaining dead at the close of the 1,000-year reign. Revelation 20:21-24. I saw thrones on which were seated. Now these were, this was a vision that John was given by the Lord himself. He was actually given a revelation from God of what was coming in the end. Okay? I saw thrones on which were seated, those who had been given authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony about Jesus. And because of the word of God, they had not worshipped the beast or its image, not received its mark on their forehead or their hand. They came to life and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who share in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God, and the Christ will reign with him for 1,000 years. Now, once again, what all that looks like. Okay. But I know that those who believe in him, those that died before his coming, and those that are alive, that there will be those who will rise from the grave before us being caught up with him, whatever that looks like, the dead shall be raised first. Those who died before us, whatever that looks like, I'm not sure, but they will be raised to life. And then us after, I don't know the time period of that, if it's suddenly, if there's a time process, sure. The scripture says, and after that, we will be caught up together. Okay? Well, those who are Christ at a second coming, those who are his, and then his coming, there's kind of a two-part to this. Who are his? Who belong to Christ? Not everyone who professes to be his are actually his. Matthew 7:21-2. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only those who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy your name? And your name drive out demons? And your name perform many miracles? There are a lot of things that are going to happen in the end time. And some might actually be in the name of Jesus, but it might not actually be for him. The Bible says that God knows our heart and that he is actually bigger than our heart. But you actually know those who are genuinely in it for Christ and those who are genuinely in it for themselves. You will separate them. Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. Now, this is the end of Matthew 7. In the beginning, I think it was in 4 or 5, where Jesus put the disciples on the mount, and he had the Sermon on the Mount, and he started going to the Beatitudes, and he started preaching the message of hope, the gospel. He's preaching the message of the gospel. This is the new way of living and thinking. Those who live like this, and that's when he goes into 7, he says, those who follow my teaching, I'm telling you everything that's going on. If you follow it, you are building your house on the solid foundation. Those who don't, it'll be washed away. So that's basically what he's saying. Those who have a solid foundation will do the Father's will, who is in heaven. Okay? So having a revelation of what we rely on will give us the revelation of what we need to do from which we rely on. We see what's beneath us. We see what's holding us grounded. And so we operate from that foundation because we have a revelation of what keeps us afloat. Does that make sense? Timothy 2:19. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with this inscription. The Lord knows who are his, and everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must turn away from wickedness. God is very plain on this. There are a lot of issues that are mystery. This one is not. That's why the first doctrine we talked about was repentance. First foundational teaching, turning from your way of thinking and living, because people think wickedness is some evil, nasty, you know, we have this idea of wickedness, but God says anything against me is wickedness. And so turn from that thought process and not your own understanding of wickedness. Because people can only turn from certain things they think are bad and think certain things are good, and God says, well, those good things are still against me. So the second half of those who are his and those who are his at his coming. So we'll look at about his coming. In the Greek, the coming talks about being near. Okay? The word coming clarifies when the resurrection event will take place, which is the return of Jesus. Paul gives clarification and describes how Christians will be resurrected to meet Christ at his coming. 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. Brothers and sisters, do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind, who have no hope. But we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we'll be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage another with these words. So I want to kind of understand. understand what's going on here in the context. Paul was comforting believers who had lost their relatives. But those relatives were also believers. So he was saying, listen, all who have died in the faith of the gospel refers to them as those who have fallen asleep. Paul wanted them to understand the resurrection and the coming of the Lord. Listen, there was still hope. Because of who they believed in, they too shall rise. So there are, Paul describes three dramatic sounds before this happened. There was a shout from the Lord. The voice of Christ alone carries the power to raise the dead. We have to believe that. John 5:28. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who hear in their grave, when all who hear are in their graves will hear his voice. Whether believer or not, the power of God's voice of Jesus, everyone who is not alive will hear that voice. The Bible says that all knees will bow. All tongues will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And so for me, I would rather do that now, where I fully understand a lifestyle of change, where I willingly bow to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I am in love with you and I want to serve you, than him making me bow down. That's just me, and I believe a lot of people might want to feel that way too. The second is the voice of an archangel. Some say possibly Gabriel. I don't know. But he does appear four times in the Bible, and all of them being a messenger from God. You can just Google Gabriel, he appears in Daniel, of scriptures, but I believe it's four times in the Bible he appears, and he is representing as a messenger of God. Well, it could be him, I don't know. And the trumpet of God. Through scripture, the shofar, which we even blow in the church sometimes, you'll hear that blow. That is a trumpet call. That is to gather God's people. That was the symbol behind the shofar. When they blow it, those who are like-minded in faith would come and gather together. Everyone just kind of knew what it was, they heard it, and they gathered. Okay? So those are the three sounds that we hear before our understanding in 1 Thessalonians 4. I know there's a lot here. There's just so much to it, and there's a lot of verses, and I hope you can gather what you can, but I encourage you to go back to the video when we have it up on Tuesday or after, and just kind of maybe go through a little bit. So, there are three things that will follow from the three sounds from heaven. We have the three sounds, and now we have three things that will follow. All who are asleep in Christ will be resurrected. All true believers who are alive on the earth at that moment will undergo an instantaneous and supernatural change in their body. Now, many can have many ideas what that looks like. All I know is I'm excited to be a new creation, a new being. You know, he put us on the earth to be in his image. You know, now that's going to come, in the end, it's going to come into a complete, he's going to complete that. That we are being the fullness of his children. I don't know what that looks like, but I mean, it should really excite every believer. 1 Corinthians 15:51-52, listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trumpet will be sound, we will be raised imperishable, we will be changed. Both parties of believers will be swiftly, supernaturally caught up with Jesus in the air. Like I said, I don't know the time for that. Scripture says swiftly, after, you know, so you have these words that can kind of make you think, okay, this is going to happen pretty close together. The Greek word for caught up speaks of a violent grab. A lot of times in the Christian faith, they use the word rapture. Rapture is not actually in the Bible, but is the term referred to being caught up with him, and there are many teachings on the rapture. And many teachings say they have it. This is what's going to happen. And that does concern me a little bit. Maybe somebody down the pike can be right, but when everyone thinks that they're right and they don't align, that's what concerns me. And so we can guess and have an idea. There's talks about, well, post-tribulation rapture, pre-tribulation rapture, the tribulation period. where there's going to be a lot of good suffering going on and heartache and pain. Are we going to be gone before that? Are we going to be gone after that? And there's just a lot of teachings on it. All I know is one thing that Jesus talks about when he talks about the parable of the 10 virgins is basically have your lamp. Have oil in your lamp. Have the Holy Spirit inside of you. You don't even have to worry about it. You don't have to conjure up ideas about it. You can just rest in God's peace and say, Lord, when it happens, hallelujah, it happens. Do what you got to do. That's where I'm. But people spend their whole life on eschatology. Eschatology is basically the teaching of the end time. And so people spend their whole life on eschatology and completely miss what God is doing. Transform the life. To change something. Everyone's all caught up in going to heaven or hell. Heaven or hell. Well, my goal now is to represent heaven on earth because people are going through hell right now. In their eyes. And so the heart of the believer is to say, how can we transform that now? Not that we can't be ready and prepared, because we're called to be prepared, but to be completely caught up in only the end will rob somebody of the now. Does that make sense? I get started thinking about it. So Revelation 16:15. Look, I come like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake and remains clothed, so as not to go naked and be shamefully exposed. Basically, they're saying, look, just be ready. Just be ready. There are five distinct changes that take place when the transformation of our body takes place. We know we are sown in corruption, but we'll also be raised in incorruption. We know we are sown in a mortal body, but we will be raised in immortality. We are sown in dishonor. We are separated from Christ at birth. We are sown in dishonor, but we shall be raised in glory. We are sown in weakness, but we will be raised in power. We are sown in a natural body, but we will be raised in a spiritual body. Yes. And all that can be found in 1 Corinthians 15:35, 42-45, and 52-53. That's where those are found. Understand this is, I mean, what, even when I go through this stuff and they're like, this is the elementary teaching of Christ. Let's go, you know, that he wants to take us on to more mature things. The possibilities of getting deep with God are honestly endless. God can take you to such a deep place that you were in such a place of oneness with him, but he does require for us to know these things, and maybe not on this intellectual level, how some people process things, but just having an understanding that there are some basic principles in life, you know, that we know God is going to come back to. He's coming back for sure. I do all the time. He's not coming back for Caleb. He loves Caleb, and he wants to transform Caleb, but God's always got a bigger picture in all his church, his bride. He's coming back for a bride. Praise God, Caleb is. Right? He's not coming back for a personal person, but a collective, singular, the church. Those, there are many disagreements within the church. There are many different teachings and doctrines. There are over 35,000 different Christian denominations. And every one of them probably thinks they have it right.
I know we do.
Right? Thank God we're non-denominational. Right? But that we are brothers and sisters. And as long as the heart of us is the Lord, I want to get it right. That we don't really get to choose our spiritual family. And that, you know, God says, listen, it's messy now, but he's coming back for a spotless bride. And so we still have a lot of work to do. So that's why I'm not so focused on the end times. Because, I mean, there's been even false prophetic words put on billboards, dates of when the end is coming. And the last time I checked scripture, Jesus says, no one knows the time or the hour except the Father. Even Christ himself doesn't know the time. how dare we conjure the time and put the Lord's stamp of approval on it? That is a disservice to God and his body and people who have the potential to come into faith. Scary stuff. That's why you must. Don't you must. I can all I can tell you what the scriptures say, and it's that we gotta be at peace with, you know what? I just don't. To be at peace in mystery. It's a perfect peace. It's a shalom. I'll be speaking about shalom later on, peace that we all desire. But we can have that peace and rest and not know it. So we talked about the first at the coming of Christ or the first resurrection. We talked about those who were buried and dead or asleep in the previous ages until his return. And then we'll be caught up with them at some point. And we will be glorified with him and reign with him for 1,000 years, which is the millennial time. And now in the final resurrection, which is called the end, which describes the following events. 1 Corinthians 24. I don't want to talk about that. I hope you can find that first. 24, I think it's between 24 to 26. You can check that. But then the end will come when he hands over the kingdom to God, the Father, after he has destroyed all dominion, authority, and power, for he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. This is after the 1,000-year reign, and Jesus returns to release Satan and destroy death. The Bible says that during a 1,000-year reign, that he bound Satan up. Satan was locked away. But after that, he released him for a period of time. Okay? 2 Peter 3:9 says, let me skip it. God will give opportunity during the millennium to come to him. So there will be a period of time which looks absolutely horrible. I don't know what that looks like. But God is so gracious and loving that he is still giving people an opportune time to come to him. Okay? So 2 Peter 3:9 says, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you for us, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come. That is his heart. But at the final resurrection, the remaining dead will rise, and they will be judged. Revelation 20:12. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done and recorded in the book. I don't know what all that looks like. I can conjure up some ideas. But all I know is that those who repent, believe in him, and walk in his ways, their name will be written. We don't have to worry about the other day. Okay? Revelation 20, 7 through 14. When the 1,000 years are over, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, and to gather them for battle. In number, they are like the sand on the seashore. They march across the breadth of the earth and surround the camp of God's people. The city he loved. What that looks like. At all. But fire came down from heaven and devoured them. And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of burning sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet had been thrown. They will be tormented day and night, forever and ever. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from its presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were open. Another book was open, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. And the sea gave up the dead that were in it. And death and Hades gave up the dead that were in it. Each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Every realm is called by God to give up the dead. The sea, the death, or death and Hades. Death and Hades are both a condition and are beings or angels. Revelation 6:8 says, I looked, and there before me was a pale corpse. Its rider was named Death. And Hades was following close behind them. They were given power over a fourth of the earth to kill by sword, famine, and plague, and by the wild beasts of the earth. Now, I don't even know what they were to look like or anything like that. But mostly, we only understand them as a condition, definitely a condition. But death, in the spiritual sense, also being a being. Okay? Death is a minister of Satan that claims the bodies of the unrighteous. Hades is a minister of Satan that takes charge of the spirits of the unrighteous, which have been claimed by the death and conducts them, and conducts them to the realm of departed spirits from which he received Hades. I know the eyes are like this. Crazy. I get it. I get it that we don't get it. I understand it completely. But when we throw it out there, it gives us an opportunity to seek God on it even more. You know? And it's not like the condition has to be, you have to know absolutely everything I'm saying to you right now in order to be one of the life or one of the living. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying is that, you know, we're just called to be aware of what's going on and the importance of reading the scripture and the prophetic words to come that help us understand to be a little more ready and prepared. Because no one even thinks about heaven and earth being wiped away. God's doing away with what is now. The heavens now, gone. Done. The earth now, gone. Done. Most Christians, or a lot of Christians, don't even understand that concept or have never even been trained on it. But it will be gone. And he's going to start everything new. And he will be the sun. He will be the light for us. And we will reign with him. And we'll be in charge of responsibilities. There are rewards in heaven that we will be in charge of according to what we've done on the earth. Now, we can either, you know, try and rely on fire insurance. I don't want to go that route. Or we can be stewards of what God has given us on the earth and live for him. And when he says, well done, good and faithful servant, now I have things for you to do in eternity. In my realm, you are now entering my realm. You will be my children. And you will be so happy, so glad, so amazed. You will see colors that you've never seen before. You will see things you cannot even imagine are possible. But they are for you to have your hope. I don't know what it all looks like, but it excites me. Okay? So there are basically two categories of people who participate in the resurrection of life that the scriptures talk about. The Queen of Sheba and the men of Nineveh. Luke 11, 31 and 32, the queen of the south will rise at the judgment with the people of this generation and condemn them, for she came from the ends of the earth to listen to Solomon's wisdom. And now something greater than Solomon is here. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And now something greater than Jonah is here. And then the righteous who died during this millennium, right? During the time when God takes the dead from the grave and those who are still alive, there's this process of life still going on this earth. He hasn't done away with earth yet. I do know that. And so there's this period of time where people can still come to him. And so those who died during that millennium will also come in the end in that final resurrection. And they too have the name in the book of life. The resurrection of the dead is something that can completely drive somebody away from wanting to know anything more about God if they only want to rely on their understanding. Because it can just sound absolutely crazy. And alien and foreign, and like this is not a reality. I would rather put my faith in this teaching and in these words and just be at rest with what happened. Because I know God is going to take care of me. Right? So I don't really know what all the is. I don't know what it all looks like. I'm just pulling up scripture and trying to go off of that. I'm not an in-depth eschatological teacher where I can tell you this, and this is going to happen to align the sun, the moon, and the stars. I don't do that. That's not me. But my heart is to focus on the now and to have oil in the lamp now. So when the time comes, we are prepared, even though we don't know it. There are those who want to know it all and cannot be prepared. But I'd rather be the one who doesn't know it all, but just be prepared. That's the importance of getting back to the first foundational teaching. Being to our faith, learning to put him in all of his ways. The end times are part of his ways. So, with that being said, we've got 15 minutes. Maybe we can have some discussion or dialogue if you want. Any thoughts? Any questions that maybe you might have that I can try to answer? Like I said, it's important to go back to it. You know, when the teaching comes up and you go back to the scriptures, you know, because and there's just so many questions I even, you know. But I know the last two are important because they deal with God. And getting the first four under our belt and in our heart and our concept of time and our realm God gave us will prepare us for the last two that end of the day. Because I always thought eternity was, okay, it's before time and an after time. And I even preached that because it was my understanding. I put a rope out and it had A and B. And I wasn't completely wrong, but I was just lack on more revelation of what it is. And so I'd have, okay, this is the beginning, and this is the end. You have Genesis, you have Revelation. God gives us a concept of time, and the whole thing between is a love story. Right? God loses his children in the beginning because we decided to do that. We have to look at taking ownership as an act of humanity, not individual. And so God's plan doesn't change to the whole point from A to B. We have the beginning of time. We are with him in his kingdom on earth. He created a realm of the invisible and made it visible in the Garden of Eden. So they had this direct connection with God, and then they lost it. And then we have this process of destruction. God says, my promise is still here. I'm taking my people, Israel, and I'm taking those who aren't Israel, who are the Gentiles, and I'm still making them all together. I'm taking humanity, and I still have a plan for them. Right? Now, God's plan didn't change. God didn't say, I need a plan B because they messed up. Because before the foundation of the earth was laid, Jesus already died on the cross. That's already in the book. It happened in the realm of eternity. It just didn't happen yet in the realm of our time. Does that make sense? And so Jesus comes back to restore the keys to the kingdom and to give us hope. And now after that, we carry the presence of the Holy Spirit while Jesus is with God at the right hand. We now carry out the rest of it until the end times come. And then in the end, we will be caught up with him. And we will reign with him, and he will wipe away every single tear. No more crying, no more weeping, no more nothing. We who believe in him will be with him in his realm forever and ever. That's all I really know. But that alone excites me. So, any thoughts?
Yeah, I have a thought. It's not really a question, okay?
knowing the word, Jesus said, hey, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would tell you, I go to prepare a place for you. Mm-hmm. Well, mansions are dwelling places. Okay, that's how we think of them. As far as like eternity, when you think of eternity and our life in time here on earth, this is like one of those realms, as we call it, that God created. It's in eternity. It's still a part of eternity. But you could think of it almost like a mansion that God made. A mansion that God made, a place for us to live in the physical, in time, and also a place where he's restricted the devil until the end. This is a thought.
Yeah.
A question.
No, it's not a bad thought at all. Because, you know, what we tie that to is the fact that God's heart is to see the invisible realm manifested. Right? There's no sickness where he dwells. But yet he calls for us to lay hands on the sick. Right? There's no death. There's no weeping. There's no worry. There's no anxiety. There's none of that. There's just peace. There's joy. There's relationship. And so he wants that manifested here. So in a sense, you know, our responsibility is to say, how can we make eternity seen to the best of what God gives us in our revelation and what he reveals to us? You know, and so that's what people will ultimately be drawn to, is that everyone is searching for something. But what he put in the heart, that it says in Ecclesiastes, that God has set eternity in the hearts of men. He has set eternity inside of humanity. So us, as we don't know him, we long to know him, but we go through other vices in life, searching. Our souls are searching, right? Our thought process towards addictions and drugs and wealth, you know, and all these possessions. You know, that's why he says, don't store up yourself treasures on earth, but store up yourself treasures in heaven where they can't be destroyed, right? Moths cannot come and rust cannot come and they can't be tampered with. Everything here, if you leave it alone, it just fades away. Right? If you think about it, if you don't tend to something, it'll just fade and rust and rot. But it doesn't happen there. It's constant life. And so God's heart is for us to represent constant life. To speak life, to breathe life, to be life. Right? And so that's what Jesus did, and that's what he called us to do. And next week, we're going to talk about eternal judgment. The next process, those two go together, because that also is the end teaching that comes through the realm of eternity, because we will either dwell with him in eternity, or we will be separated. And that's a hard thing to swallow. But God is sovereign. God gives opportunity for all of us to come to him. But we have to submit our free will. That will be our teaching next week. Good? All right. Amen.